Welcome to Mixtape Memoir with the Seattle Public Library. My name is Reagan Jackson. I am the program director for Young Women Empowered and a freelance journalist and a writer. I have written three collections of poetry, two children's books, and I've also been published in several different anthologies. All of which you can probably find at the Seattle Public Library. I was also a columnist for the Seattle Globalist and for the South Seattle Emerald. And you might have read my work in Crosscut, Yes Magazine, the Black Girl Nerds blog, or various other places. So I'm here today to connect with you about memoir. We are going to do a couple of free writes and timed writes. So I would love it if you prepared by having a pen and paper. First things first, I want to introduce you to an unpublished book that has been very important and very influential to my life. It's called Harvesters, The Stories of Our Lives. This is actually an anthology created by some elderly retired folks who put together their own memoirs, and included in it are three memoir stories from my grandmother. She gave it to me after she took this class through, I think, the University of Iowa. And I was really excited to read it, but life happened, I got busy, and I kind of just put it on a shelf and I didn't pick it up until a couple of years later. And when I did, and I sat down and I read it, I was like, wow, in five pages, my grandmother has managed to explain our entire family and how she thinks and how she has conducted her life. And it was something that was incredibly powerful to me. And one of the things that inspired me to begin teaching memoir is because I realized that in sharing these stories about your lives, there's a real opportunity for connection and for deep understanding. So this is important work that we're involved in, that we're doing. So later on in this, I will be sharing a piece that I wrote. But before we get to that, the first thing I like to do with every new writer, every writer who is working with me, is I like to do some short timed writing. So we're gonna do 3-minute time writes, so you can hopefully have something to time yourself with. And I'm just gonna give you the prompts, and then I would love it if you just pause the video and do the task, and then come back to me. So the very first 3-minute writing prompt that I want you to write on is, I don't write because, dot, dot, dot. I don't write because, or, what I'm afraid of in writing this memoir is dot, dot, dot. So what we want to do is just, even if like maybe you're one of those fearless people and this is an easy thing, a fun thing, a light thing that you're going to do, I think there are still reasons or feelings that come up around why writing can be challenging, or what happens when we're trying to write. So take a moment now for 3 minutes and just write down any block or fear or obstacle, anything that prevents you from doing this work. Okay. So you're back from that. Hopefully it didn't traumatize you too much. And the next thing I want you to do, because we're going to get to that. One is, I just want to say, The top five things that people are afraid of or that prevent people from writing memoir. One, other people and their opinions. Like, so you have your version of the story and they have their version of the story, and what if someone challenges you? Or time. Oh, it's just, I'm so busy, I just don't have time to write. fear of what bringing up old memories might bring up. Uh-oh. And we're going to address that one in a minute too. Or maybe it's just, I don't know if I have enough skill as a writer to really convey or express what it is that I want to deeply express. And so it's that fear of failure that keeps this from starting. Or number five, the thing that a lot of writers write down is, I just don't know where to start. So we're going to address the top five fears or blocks to writing as we go through this. But first, I'm just going to share a screen. I'd like you to write a give list. So what is a give list? Take a piece of paper, draw a line down the middle, and on the left, you're going to write what you are hoping to receive out of writing. And for many people, when approaching memoir, you could be wanting to share your story, or maybe just to get it out. Like, it could be something therapeutic. There's something cathartic about writing your experiences. Or it could be, like my grandmother wrote for me, it could be leaving a legacy for your loved ones, letting them get a glimpse into a deeper part of who you are or things that they might not have readily understood. So I want you once again to set the timer for 3 minutes and just work on the left column. Work on what is it that you want to get out of this project? What do you want to receive? Okay. So we're going to do one last 3-minute session, and this is your give list. Everything in life is an energetic exchange. If you are hoping to receive clarity of thought or having other people understand you or sharing your story, then you have to be willing to give something to get that. I think this is actually true with everything. Like, you can make a give list for lots of situations, for jobs, for partnership, for friendships, because I said, everything in life is an energetic exchange, and you have to be willing to put a little skin in the game in order to get what you want. So you're going to write your give list. What are you willing to give? How much time are you willing to spend on your memoir? There's no wrong answer. It could be 5 minutes. It could be 5 hours. It could be 5 decades. Like, it doesn't really matter. It's just a question of what. And then what else are you willing to give to this? Are you willing to be honest in your work? Are you willing to face criticism? Are you willing to be reflective? Are you willing to dive deep? So for 3 minutes, just take time and write what you're willing to give. Okay, well, congratulations. In doing those 3 lists, you are now prepared to write. Now, this is kind of a fun thing. If you do have a friend that you're taking this class with, I think it now would be a good time for you to stop the video again and just chat with them about your list. Did anything come up that surprised you? Was anything unexpected in what you're willing to give? Was your list of what you wanted to receive balanced with what you wanted to give? Because that's another thing that people don't always take into account. Like, I might have a list that's like, oh, I want to receive all these things, these accolades. I want to win like awards for this story. I want to do this. I'm going to do that. But I only have 5 minutes every 5 weeks to give. Like, that's, you might not be giving enough in order to get what you want. So it's good to evaluate. And also, in terms of your fears, I think it's good for you to think through, like, what's preventing you from doing this work? And then decide that you're willing to put that on hold, that maybe that is less important than what you want to receive and what you're willing to give. But yes, it's important to have all 3 lists. So I would love to share with you an excerpt from a really lovely book called 7,000 Ways to Listen by Mark Nepo. This is something I often share with my classes because memoir isn't like every other type of writing. Well, yes, it is. It is and it isn't. For me, all writing is cathartic. All writing is an exploration of truth and depth. But for memoir especially, since you're going into your own personal stories and you're talking about your life, not everybody has lived an easy life. And there might be trauma. And as you begin remembering, sometimes you're flooded with more memories than feel safe. So this is called Going Back into the Fire. Let the gift stitch or cut the web. Let what needs to come together or break apart, come together or break apart. Let the miracles, even the ones we don't want or see, unfold. Licia was severely burned in a gas fire when she was 9. Her traumatic fear of fire grew to dominate her life. If someone left a gas grill on while eating, she began to sweat. More than 30 years later, Licia woke with the notion that she must go back into the fire in order to replace that awful, life-changing moment with another. She worked with firefighters who set up a controlled fire. She wore a fire suit and walked into the flames and just stood there, at first feeling alarmed by her fear, which had enveloped her for so long. Slowly, her fear started to melt, and she began to see through the intense heat. The world was waiting beyond the flames. She opened her palms and watched the tall flames curl around her fingers without being able to burn her. As she walked out of the fire, she could feel the wall of heat part and rejoin behind her. As the coolness of simple air surrounded her again, she could feel her heart, cramped so far inside for more than 30 years, begin to relax and even expand. For Licia, the fire was actual. For many of us, our pain is real enough, but the fire is often a wound or fear that keeps burning us up. This is why we need a controlled fire to go back into without getting hurt. It is difficult to listen to life, each other, or the voice of spirit if everything is muffled and distorted through the constant flames of pain or fear. And this is, I'm skipping down a little bit on the page for this beautiful little moment. It says, but how? It is said that souls intent on living will reach deep into their wound and bring out the fire living there, which out in the open turns to light. It is said that those intent on making things better will reach deep into their minds and bring out the fire there, which out in the open turns to truth. It is said that those who love, like rain, soothe every fire. So this is an act of love that you're doing for yourself and for anyone who you allow into your memoir world. Because that's another thing. You don't have to share the work that you're writing with anyone. And in the beginning, I think that takes off a bit of pressure so that also you're not writing for someone else necessarily. You're writing for yourself. You're writing to tell your story, to share your words. And in some cases, to go back into that fire. So in the same way that Licia came up with a plan for how to go back into the fire safely, before you dive deep, particularly if you're going to be telling a story that's challenging, I recommend that you put a plan in place. Do you have a good therapist? Do you have friends or family that are willing to hold your hand through this process? Reach out or set boundaries for yourself. You don't have to do anything that feels like it's too much of a risk or that's too uncomfortable. So going back to what is memoir? I think a lot of people conflate autobiography with memoir and think that when they're writing a memoir, they have to tell their entire life story. That's not what memoir is. And this is actually one of the benefits of memoir is that you don't have to tell everything. A memoir can be a short vignette. It can tell the period, it can tell the story of a period of time in your life or a specific memory or memories that are grouped up by a specific category. But either way, it's a very manageable way to begin that process of talking about what you've experienced and what you've lived. So I like the format that I call mixtape memoir. So I don't know how old any of you are. So some of you might remember the thing called a mixtape. It's what an ancient medium now of self-expression through music. I just remember in middle school, my friends and I would make each other mixtapes, and every tape had to have a theme, and each song was, you know, in alignment with the theme or had was like a special message. And it was especially fun if you were making a mixtape for like a crush or someone that you wanted to like express, oh, I like you feelings for. You can put together a whole I like you mix, or maybe it was summertime and you just wanted something that you could play out at the lake. So for me, one of my entry points into memoir has been songs, because so much of my life has been set to a soundtrack. For you, think about what sense is most prevalent in your memories. Is it taste? Is it touch? Is it sound? And I think start from there. What did the house smell like on holidays? What was your favorite taste as a kid? These are all places that you can start. And I think that time writing is especially a good way to jumpstart if you're trying to just get going. So you can say, okay, I'm gonna write about this prompt for 30 minutes. And then at the end of the 30 minutes, like look at what you have. And so I would like to give you my list, my mixtape list. So I'm going to share screen with you once more. This is what I call a pre-funk assignment. And oftentimes when I teach this class, I will send this out before anyone has class and they will fill it out. So basically it's a list of 16 songs that would be on the soundtrack to your life. So number one, the song that was playing at your birth, literally or figuratively, what it should have been. Two, the song that you want played at your funeral. Three, a song that reminds you of someone special or important in your life. Four, a song that makes you cry. Five, a song that makes you want to punch somebody in the face, or the song you wish was playing when you did punch somebody in the face, if that's the thing that you have had experience with. Six, the song you wished would play outside of your window while reenacting Lloyd Dobler's romantic tribute and Say Anything. If you haven't seen that movie, you should just at least Google that part. There's a little YouTube link in here. But basically a song that reminds you of a moment of love's expression. Seven, a song that feels like it stole its lyrics from something that happened in your life. Eight, the song that sums up your childhood. Nine, a song that tells a secret about you. 10, the song that no one would ever guess that you love that has at some point been on repeat. 11, the song that reminds you of your greatest triumph. 12, the song that reminds you of your greatest failure. 13, a song that sums up your feelings about adulthood. 14, a song that embodies your purest joy. 15, your favorite breakup anthem. And 16, your superhero theme song. So I will request that when they send you this video, that they also send you this list so you can look over it. My recommendation is that you pick songs for each of these. And then the next part is to pick one of these songs and write the story of the song. So I am going to share with you one of the songs that I wrote, or one of the stories of the songs that I wrote. The song prompt is inspired by Shanice. I love your smile. I'm just going to play a little short excerpt of it, and then I'm going to read it for you. I am just like you.
world. Yeah. I can't hear the teacher. Who's gonna call me at all? I don't see the bad boys trying to get some play. Cause I love it.
It there, but you get the idea. Wow, that was a jam back in the day. It was a All right, and yet for me it was not the best memory, so bear with me, but I am gonna share with you. The posters were everywhere, plastered on lockers, on the sherbert green walls by the classroom, on the cafeteria door, and even in the bathroom announcing the I Love Your Smile fashion show. It was sponsored by a department store. They had professionals who would come and do your hair and makeup, and you got to pick out the outfits you wore. All the Black girls were doing it. Melissa was doing it too. We were friends, even though we didn't have much in common. In a way, we were opposites. I was the Black girl who lived in a white neighborhood, who all the Black girls looked down on. And she was the white girl who lived in the Black neighborhood, who all the white kids looked down on. Our common friends were a group of blue-eyed, ride-or-die white girls, tomboys who played soccer and climbed trees and didn't really fit in any more than I did. But Melissa was also friends with the girls from her neighborhood. I envied her ease with them. The way they waved her over in the cafeteria at lunch or let her sit next to them in class. Sometimes they would braid her hair, or I'd look over and see them laughing together about someone or something I knew nothing about. They wore hoop earrings, straightened hair, and Jordache jeans. I wore the clothes my mother picked out for me, and it showed. Fluffy, formless sweaters with olive khakis and off-brown shoes. Even when I wore jeans, they weren't the right kind. I only had one cross colors t-shirt, and that seemed to be something I could wear without ridicule. But for the most part, I got it wrong. From my natural hair to my makeupless face. The way I walked, the way I talked, the things I said were all wrong. The same girls who laughed with Melissa laughed at me. Sometimes the older ones would trail behind me in the hallway and talk loudly about my hair or my clothes, but mostly they alternated between pitying me or accusing me of being stuck up and talking white. I never quite knew which was worse. But one thing I knew was that the fashion show, and really any event that all the other Black kids were involved in, was not something I would be welcome at. Still, in the way white girls do, Melissa seemed oblivious to the invisible cloud of uncool that surrounded me, as well as the eye rolls and insults aimed like darts at my back. "It'll be fun," she said. "We can pick out matching outfits." I don't think I ever convinced myself it would be fun, but I did desperately want to wear clothes that made me feel like less of a target. I thought maybe if I figured out how to dress or showed them I could be fun, that they would see I was one of them, just a regular Black girl, someone they could be friends with. So I did the stupid thing and signed up to participate. Melissa and I went to the store together and picked out our matching outfits. Hers was a short and t-shirt set in pinks and purples, and mine was a set of short overalls and a top in the same colors. On the morning of the fashion show, before I went to school, I sat between my mother's knees while she oiled my scalp and braided my hair. I only wanted two braids, but she was feeling creative and did several and clipped the ends with plastic baubles. It was throwback hair, perfectly acceptable in elementary school and totally inappropriate for middle school. But this was a reoccurring theme. I just had to get through the day, focus on being nice, but not too nice, and not saying or doing anything too stupid. Who knows, maybe someone might even talk to me. I ignored the sinking feeling in my stomach and hoped for the best. When the bell rang and school let out, I followed the trail of girls to a classroom where the hair and makeup people had set up. Most of the girls already had straightened hair, so the lady just gave them a couple of curls with a curling iron. The styles were nice though, nothing special. But after the hairdresser finished, the other girls oohed and aahed about how grown up they looked. I sat across from Melissa, looking into the mirror at my own little girl hairstyle, and made a snap decision that I was going to get my hair done. There wasn't much time before the show, so I had to hurry. I unbraided the first braid, thinking I could still change my mind if I wanted to. Then the second. But then, almost all of the girls had gone, so Melissa came over and helped me unbraid the rest of my hair. It was my turn, so I sat down in the chair. The lady began to comb through my thick, unstraightened hair. It was stiff with blue magic hair oil that sizzled when she tried the curling iron. She held it there for a minute and then untwirled it, but my hair remained a law unto itself, completely uncooperative. She tried once more before giving up. "I'm sorry, sweetheart. There's just too much grease in your hair and I don't have time to wash it." As soon as she said it, my pulse began to quicken. I couldn't go up on stage without my hair done. This was a disaster. I felt the lump of unspent tears welling up in the back of my throat. Melissa gave me a quarter and I went to call my mom. "I need you to come and braid my hair again." This was met with a confused silence. And then, "I braided your hair this morning." "Yeah, I know. But there was a hairdresser and all the other girls were getting their hair done. But she said there's too much oil in my hair to style it. So I need you to come and braid it again." "Reagan, I'm at work." Four words, and the tears burst forth unbidden. No one had outright laughed at me yet. There were too many adults in the room for them to be so open, but we all knew what was coming. I was going to be talked about like a dog. I tried once more to convince her, but I knew that this time she got there, I knew that by the time she got there, it would be too late anyway. "Why would you unbraid your hair?" she asked, completely missing the crisis. I told her not to worry and hung up, tears streaming down my face. I had been embarrassed before, but the crying was humiliating. No matter what they said or didn't say, I had always managed to do my crying in private, and now, just an hour before the big show, I was a sobbing mess of greasy-haired girl. Seeing my distress, even though she didn't fully understand the level of social faux pas I committed or why I was so desolate, Melissa offered to braid my hair. I pulled a wad of scratchy brown paper towels from the dispenser and tried to stop the tsunami while she attempted to run a comb through my hair. Neither of us were successful. White girls have thin and silky hair. I'm sure she had braided her own hair or maybe her doll's hair or her sister's, but faced with the unfamiliar texture, she couldn't even really comb it properly. For someone so down with black girls, she didn't know shit about black hair. This is what you get from having white girlfriends. Even when they want to help you, they couldn't. I had stopped crying, but I started again when I realized that this just was not going to work. "Time to get dressed, ladies." We were ushered into a different classroom where the racks of clothing had been left marked with our names. Melissa and I tried on our matching outfits, and though they had looked cute in the store, suddenly they seemed babyish and overly bright. Mine fit weird, and I tugged at it uncomfortably. "You look pregnant," a girl said to me. I didn't say a word, not to her or to Melissa, who tried to defend me. I turned to see myself in the mirror. The roundness of my belly did press up against the fabric. My hair stood out in greasy clumps. I had never felt blacker, fatter, nappier, or uglier than in that precise moment. Tears didn't do it justice. More than that, I had never looked nor felt more miserable. What had I been thinking? I knew how this would end before it began, and still, I wanted so desperately to fit in, to belong to these girls who clearly wanted nothing to do with me, but who were also simultaneously the closest image of who I thought I was supposed to be, that I had ignored my instincts. "Come here," a girl named Conjetta said, taking my hand. She was new, a transplant from Texas, but already the other girls had accepted her as one of their own. She sat me down in a hardback chair, parted my hair, and did two simple French braids. They weren't as tidy or well-structured as what my mother had done, but they were good enough. "Thank you," I whispered. "That's cute," someone said, and it was the first time any of them had ever said a single nice thing to me or towards me, though really it was directed towards Conjetta for being a good Samaritan. Melissa still bent on cheering me up, babbled on about how everyone thought my hair was cute and how much fun it was going to be on a real catwalk. I don't remember getting on the stage or how I got home or what my mother said about my hair. I just remember the song, I Love Your Smile, playing. Years later, whenever it came on the radio, I would always change the station, but never fast enough to avoid that twisting feeling in my stomach. All right, friends. Thank you for attending my class. It's been a pleasure, and I hope you get something out of it. Take care.